Radio V. Radio in TV.
Radio in TV.
He's absolutely Jason. He's absolutely gay. He'll absolutely brighten up the darkest rainy day. He's funny and loves movies. He's smart and he's a Jew. He's an actor and an activist and wants to hear from you.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to Absolutely Jason Stewart. Today's guest is my new pal, Tony Dennison, from Major Crimes and The Closer. And so we met, I think, on the set of The Closer when I was guest starring the first time.
Yes.
And then we just did a film called Dirty Together.
Mm-hmm.
And you play Commander
Rocco.
And I play this guy, Manny. Manny Brown talks like this.
Yeah.
And it was so great because we, by coincidence, we live in the same neighborhood, so we've seen each other in the market.
Probably,
and stuff.
Yeah,
and we had a lot of fun chatting on the set, and you were nice enough to come and do the show.
My pleasure.
And I got to tell you, you have just the most impressive career, in a sense, because you've been on 3 hit television shows, which just doesn't happen.
Uh-huh.
I mean, there must be a group of people that have been on 3 hit TV shows. If people don't know you guys, know him, I mean, you've been under a rock. So Major Crimes is going into the third season?
Major Crimes is going into a third season, which in a sense is the 10th season of the ensemble that was The Closer.
So let's start at the beginning, I guess. It'd be better. So,
because it's not a spinoff in the true sense of the word.
It's a retool.
It's just the same show under a different name.
With different people.
Without certain people, yeah.
Yeah. Kara Sedgwick.
Well, there's also J.K. Simmons and Corey Reynolds. You know, they're
and
gone
one
as well.
Other and a couple other
no, that's
pretty
it.
Girls. Gina.
Gina. Yeah.
Yeah.
Gina Rivera. Yeah.
Yeah,
she was gone a while. She was gone a while before
I watched
that.
The shows. Yeah. So, how did you start acting? What's the story? Where did you start?
Well, I was a newspaper editor, and the paper I was the editor of had merged with another paper, and I. The other editor, what happened was the publisher said, all right, we're going to have a meeting as to who's going to take over the combined newspaper. So I said, all right. He said, but only people with stock in the company can vote. So the publisher obviously had stock and the editor of the other paper had stock. So the vote was 2-1 against me being the editor of the new venture. And so I was, let go. I got unemployment. I was unemployed for a while. And then what happened was, pardon me. My ex-wife at the time said, why don't you take a continuing education class at the college where I graduated from? It was near where I was running this paper.
And how old were you around? In your 20s?
I was 27.
God.
26, 27. And I said...
So for being an actor, you were like old.
Yeah,
starting
I guess
acting. Yeah.
Starting out, And but I had not ever done anything. The closest I came to doing anything was... Once, when I was a newspaper editor, they had a modeling show, and they had like people from the community, like the mayor, the chief of police, the editor, my paper, me as the editor. All these people came and modeled some clothes for charity. So that's the closest I've ever, other than in the first grade, I was in a play, I think, my parents told me. And but anyway, so I went to look up what they have at the school, and they had all different kinds of classes, and the ones that seemed the most doable for me was a photography class or an acting class. And because I was unemployed, I didn't want to buy a camera. And I remember
basically the whole career started because you didn't want to buy a camera.
Exactly. And my mom, God rest her soul, she used to say to me, you ought to be an actor, Anthony. She goes, because you're the greatest storyteller that ever lived, Basically, as a euphemism for you're a great liar.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
So your book should be called, I Didn't Want to Buy a Camera.
I Didn't Want to Buy a Camera. Yeah, I got out. But anyway, so what happened was I... took this class, the teacher, he took a liking to me, and there were other people in the class, too, who were in this very well-known community theater called 90 Miles
Where
Off Broadway.
Where was this?
Upstate New York in New Paltz.
Oh, okay.
And there was a very famous community theater that did near professional stuff. And so there were a lot of people there just taking refresher classes and stuff. So I was just, what is this thing? And I... And he said to me, you know, you really got something. And I said, you really? You think so? He goes, yeah, the way you walk across the stage, the way you carry yourself, the way you, you know, import yourself. He said, you know, you might want to consider doing this. So I said, you know, fine.
So you're 27, you're starting to act, and you, a couple years later, get into the, one of the most iconic television series.
Well, let me tell you what happened. The one thing that was interesting is he had me do a scene. We did scene night, along with musical recital and dance recital for the continuing education program. So we did a scene from Death of a Salesman. He was Biff, I was Happy.
I did the same scene in Nina Bosch's acting class.
And I was, you know, petrified. I said, how am I going to do? I thought about even calling in, like, pulling the fire alarm to see if the, because I was that scared. And I went upstairs, I did the thing, and I walked down stage left, and there was somebody up in the light booth doing some sort of crazy erratic sound with the flute, meaning it was Willie Loman downstairs screaming in the kitchen. And I remember I walked down there, and I took a breath, and I said, you hear that? He's doing it again. You know, that was the opening line for that scene. And as I exhaled, I could feel, sense the audience breathing and their intention on me. And in that moment, I said, oh, this is what I want to do for the rest of my life. And that's when I went out to pursue acting full time.
So you had like a moment.
I had an aha moment, I guess they call it.
It's Oprah calls it the aha moment. Mm-hmm. So Tony Denison is quoting Oprah on my show.
I don't think I've ever met Oprah, but I know a lot of, we have a lot of mutual friends.
So how did Crime Story come about? Starring, for people don't know, it starred Dennis Farina.
It was Dennis Farina, me, Stephen Lang.
God, I love Stephen Lang. I mean, Avatar, people know him from Avatar.
Yeah, and we were the three main guys on the show.
Because it was like, it came on like gangbusters. And Andrew Dice Clay had a recurring role.
Andrew was a recurring character on the show.
And it was like, it was one of those shows that nobody, that started to use music in the show. Let's show a little clip. It's clip number, cut two. And let's show a little, just the opening credits of the show. That's all I can find.
Here's Dennis. Village Voice called me the Elvis from hell.
And all that's your hair.
It's all my hair.
And as I still walk on, I think of the things we've done.
David Caruso is
there. Oh, I forgot. David Caruso.
Still my friend today, 26 years later. You know, I don't think John Polito is in this clip. I think this is from the music video. But Polito and I are still very close friends.
He's a doll.
Oh, I love
and
John.
So, so funny.
Yeah, he's been through lots of my divorce and a whole bunch of different things. He's been like family. He's like family. Somebody said, you know it's going to be a bad day if Luca, that's my character, has a hair out of place. So I got that job. It was interesting. I got that job. Can I tell you a cute little story about what we just saw?
Yeah, yeah.
Where I'm shooting the gun out the window. They have me strapped in the car because I'm doing that stunt by myself. And so I'm strapped in the car. So in the event, you know, this is before there were shoulder straps and all that. If I hit something, I'd be okay. So I had like a waist belt hidden. And two lap belts that really just kept me glued to the seat. So when I was firing the gun out the window, they had to put in full loads in this .45. And full loads, just so they would have a big spark, a big flash, and make a really loud noise. And but the problem with a full load is when it comes out of the chamber, it is so hot that you could almost light a cigarette off of it. So
really?
I watched out of the corner of my eyes the shells ricochet up off the roof of the car I'm driving, and I don't they went and I don't know where they're going, and I'm just not really too concerned about it until all of a sudden they fell down on the seat and went under my crotch, and I was wearing like a silk, you know, a sharkskin suit, and you know, because it was a '60s period piece, a period clothing, it was starting to burn, and I'm like, trying to hold in. Like, meanwhile, you know.
So everybody said, what an intense performance.
Meanwhile, my nuts are frying. And so then when the scene was over, and so the director who was directing the second unit, he says, this guy Guzmano Cesaretti, great guy, he goes, Tony, that was a fantastic. He's Michael's, like, you know, vision man, Michael Mann's vision man, and he said, Tony, that was so fantastic. The look on your face was, he says, can you do that again? He says, when we do the, and I'm like, and so the prop guy comes over. His name was Billy. He goes, the shells went underneath, and I said, yeah. He goes, oh, God, I had two holes in my pants. I said, literally burned through my pants. And I said, well, Guzmano, I'll try to give you that look again. I mean, but it was real. It was like, you know.
So how I'm, because I'm always interested in how someone gets a job in this town.
Well, that was because my life is under the category of you never know.
And so Okay, wait, hold that thought. We're going to take a break? Okay, we've got to take a break. We're going to be back. We're running a little late today with my guest here, Tony Tennyson from Major Crimes. We'll be back in just a second. I'm absolutely Jason Stewart. You're going to tell us how he got the job, which is my favorite thing to know how someone does that. We'll be back in just a minute.
I'm Zoe Williams.
And I'm Dr. Mark Goulston.
I'm Jeff Brown.
And we make up the Zoe What Morning Show. You can find us here on tradiov.com every Monday at 11 a.m. Pacific Standard Time. I make you think.
He makes you laugh. And if I get a chance, I'll help you change.
Or make you cry with his attempts at humor.
Radio NTV.
Can you relate? We'll make it happen.
Look at Jeff. What you doing?
Were you mumbling to yourself?
Hey, back there, mumbling.
To them. To them.
Hi, I'm Katie Cleary.
And I'm Kristen Renton.
And we're from World Animal News.
World Animal News discusses animal issues from around the world.
News that matters. Watch World Animal News every Thursday at 11 a.m. Find out everything about me on Twitter at Katie_Cleary and
at Kristen Renton.
Auntie Radio V. Bing, bang, bing, boom, right?
Yeah.
Andy D. Auntie Radio V. Bobbity, bibbity, bobbity, boo. Andy D. Auntie Radio V.
The Andy Dick Show. Wednesdays from 4 to 6 p.m. on T Radio V.
Wow!
So but Paul, we'll do it. We'll do it better when the show actually starts.
Yeah, no.
T Radio V. Radio in TV.
Radio in TV.
Hey, we're back on Absolutely Jason Stewart with my guest, Tony Tennyson, telling us about how he got Crime Story, which was an iconic 80s show about the 60s, directed by or created by Michael Mann, who everybody knows from one of my favorite movies, Heat, and Collision, and, you know, have you worked with him again?
No, unfortunately,
well,
no.
You will.
Maybe one day I will.
Yeah, Michael, if you're listening, we'll send this to you, we'll tweet you.
And Michael, I owe my career to Michael. I mean, yeah. I really do.
He sort of started everything in terms of involving music, in terms of getting an emotional feeling.
He's without peer in terms of a visual frame of film. I mean, what frame of film looks like when he, you know, really, it's like paintings. And he's without peer. And, you know, Michael Mann, Bonnie Timmerman, and this woman, Julie Bavasso, they gave me my break. You know,
Julie Bavasso, the
acting.
Who's an actor, a wonderful actress, too.
She was in Saturday Night Fever. She played John Travolta's mom.
She played everybody's mom.
Yeah.
In everything.
So she's the one who recommended me to Bonnie Timmerman. Bonnie Timmerman didn't know me from a hole in the wall, said, who's this guy? Because I had no credits.
Well, gorgeous, honey. Gorgeous.
Yeah, but I had no credits. And so she put me on tape. We spent like an hour and a half in the interview. And because Julie had recommended me to her. And then she recommended me to Michael. And then I got the part. And it was so funny. The day I thought I was going to get a call at least to do something on Miami Vice, which was the hot show at the time. And I was like thinking there's, you know.
That was also Michael Mann's show, just to let people know who don't know.
And so I'm like, what's, you know, I'm not hearing anything. And then very late that night, I get a call, Tony, they're flying you to Los Angeles. And I'm like thinking, for a guest star? I said, because I didn't know it was the lead. And
you didn't know what you were reading for?
I only got sides.
So you think you were reading for Miami Vice?
No, I thought I knew I was reading for a new show called Crime Story.
Oh, okay.
And the character, but I thought because the character in was so mean and so vicious that I said he must get killed in in the pilot.
So they never even told you it was a regular part. Oh my God.
When I found out it was a regular part was when I was flying to Los Angeles and I read the script. I finally got the script for the first time and I was like, oh my God. And so what happens, I got out here, I didn't sleep, I was exhausted, I had worked all day on a commercial, I was a zombie. Michael was like really excited to see me because in his mind, I was the guy already. And so he said, what do you want to do? Because the network audition is not till 4. And I said, I got to go someplace and sleep, man. I said, I haven't slept for, almost 40 hours. I said, I've just been,
Oh, so you didn't have the part yet. You were going into test.
Going into test.
Oh, okay.
And again, I didn't know I was test until, I'm thinking, they're testing me for a guest star? I said, boy, they're really getting strict out there. And so I went back to his office at Universal. I was laying on the couch. His assistant at the time, her name was Teresa, English woman, really sweetheart. She comes in and she goes, well, I've got good news and I've got bad news. And I said, what's the, what's the good news? Well, the good news is that the audition is transferred to Saturday morning. And so you'll be able to, we're going to put you up at the Sheraton Universal so you can get some sleep. And I said, what's the bad news? Well, you have all night to worry about it. I said, no, you don't understand. That's good news and phenomenal news so that I can get that sleep. Because I felt very confident.
And exhausted.
Yeah, so I felt very confident about my work. And so they put me, and to this day, every time I go by the Sheraton Universal, now 26 years later, to this day, I go by the Sheraton Universal and I still get like an emotional pang from it. But anyway, so the next day, Saturday morning, I meet David Burke, who's still a dear friend. He's one of the executive producers, writers on the pilot and the series. And he says, I'm going to read with you. I go in and I read. And I'm in a room with everybody who later became a friend. Brandon Tartikoff was in there. And I'm...
He was the bigwig at NBC at the time.
Yeah, and then Paramount.
The biggest. I mean, at the time.
The nicest guy you ever want to meet.
But just so big.
But the most down-to-earth, genuine man. There's so many stories I could tell you about Brandon when you say, how does he remember that? We used to say in the softball team, because we wound up playing, because he was dressed to go play softball after the audition. And the team that he was going to go play on was the team that I eventually wound up playing with.
You seem more excited about the softball team than you do about Crime Story.
Well, because, Brandon was...
I'm sitting here going insane. When I was that age, I was like, I remember sitting in a line to go in for an open call for The Outsiders. I waited like 3 hours to go into it was the Coppola film, and
yeah,
every
right,
young
sure.
actor, and I'm sitting there, and they looked at me, they just went, I could see them go, oh honey, we don't know what to do with you. You don't belong. You don't exist. It's right. 1980. You don't exist right. anywhere. And you walk in, you're a wonderful actor, this intensity, gorgeous.
With no footage,
yeah.
No film. And and so anyway, I go in and I read for them. And, Michael Mann couldn't have been, there was one thing I started out, and I started like a little off, and he says, let's, because he's from Chicago, he's like, let's go back and do that other scene first, and then come back and do this one
so
after.
So he was like on your side.
And I'm thinking to myself, nobody does that. So I go back, and I do this other scene, which warmed me up, then I do the next scene, and he's down front of everybody going, giving me the thumbs up, and I'm like thinking, what does this all mean? And I go out to the waiting room waiting for them to come out, and because David Burke's got to take me back to the hotel, and I'm going to get a flight back to New York. And they all come out en masse, Michael Mann, Brandon, they all, Larry Little.
They won't remember. The audience Warren Littlefield.
So they all come out, and they say, because I know a Larry Little, who's a good friend of Brandon's, too. But anyway, they come out, and they go, you got it. You got the part. And I was like...
So you were like in a TV movie, and you were like Lana Turner to me.
Yeah.
this doesn't happen.
Right. I mean, coming from where I come from, I had a wreckage of my life. I had sort of drifted away from the business, from theater and stuff. I got involved in... I was running a gambling club in New York. It's a lot of extracurricular activities involving, illegal substances.
I knew
substances.
I should have done that. I should have run a gambling. I should have been done some, stolen a car.
So I'd given all that stuff up, and now I was, out there, my nose to the grindstone for about a year and a half, and then Crime Story came along.
Wow.
And the next thing you know, I go back to New York that night, and then Sunday afternoon, I'm in Chicago, and Monday we start rehearsals, and then Wednesday we started the series. And it was my big break.
And when the show came on, it was such a big hit.
Oh, it was, yeah. I mean, when I came out to L.A. a couple of times before I moved out here, I mean, everybody.
That was when there were, was there three or four networks? I can't remember.
It was four.
I think 1980 was when
86.
Fox came.
It was 86.
So the Fox had just started.
Fox had just started.
So it was really basically still just three
networks. Yeah, three. Big.
So I mean, it's not like, you know, whereas there's 100 now. Yeah.
I mean, you know.
You went from being the schmo.
I made choices, you know, after the show got canceled, you know, probably weren't the best. I mean,
you did Wise Guys.
I guest starred on Wise Guy when Ken Wall got hurt because David Burke had left Crime Story and went to Wise Guy. Mm-hmm. And he called me up and he said, you know, we need you to come in and be like an undercover guy. He said, we'll create a whole new character because Ken Wall is hurt.
You did so like four of them.
I did five. I did five of six. Ken did the first one, then got hurt. And then I, you know, I was with Jerry Lewis and, you know, and
what
Sam
was Jerry
Litucci.
Lewis like?
I had heard all kinds of like stories about him, like, oh my God, he's horrible. At the end of the day, I wish the guy was my uncle. He was couldn't have been nicer to me. I was thrilled working with him. I mean, it's Jerry Lewis, for God's sake.
Genius.
Yeah, I mean, you know, he's an icon.
Yeah.
And, you know, and he's one of the last of, there's only a few of them left, you know, who could say that they did projects in the 40s, you know what I mean? And there's a few fewer, you know, there's some left, more than some left, who did stuff in the 50s, but very few of them out there who did stuff in the
40s. I think Olivia de Havilland from Gone with the Wind is still alive, and there are very few. Mm-hmm. And they like that.
Right.
And she's from the 30s. Right. There are very few people that are, yeah, of that time. So you said after doing those shows, there was a turn in your career for you. I mean, because you really hit such a high so young, so quick, so fast. You know.
Yeah. You know, I don't know why. It wasn't anything I said or anything I did. Or maybe I was sending out vibrations to the universe. Because at one point I thought, you know, I want to do just feature films now. You know, tired of doing television kind of stuff. And so the universe said, okay, you know, we don't know what feature films are available for you, but we'll...
But that's the way it was in those days because there was
take
such
TV out of your life.
There was such a differentiation between TV and films. But shows like Wise Guys and Crime Story started the what I call taking television into a filmmaking way.
If you go to Netflix now and watch the pilot of Crime Story, you will watch it and say, "This show was on in 1986. Are you kidding?" I mean, that, you know, it looks like a show that could be on the air today.
Mm-hmm.
Again, that's Michael. You look at a frame of that show, and you think, I mean, people, you know, The Sopranos is a great show, and I love The Sopranos, but people used to say, you know, that Sopranos is like Crime Story with cursing and nudity.
Mm-hmm.
It's that same intense.
But I love Sopranos.
Oh, I love The Sopranos, too. I mean, I used to watch that
when
show.
When they killed Adriana, I don't know.
Jimmy was,
when they started killing people on the show, you know, I was like, man, you know, I was like.
David Chase and, you know, running that show and James Gandolfini and my buddy, my friend Joey Pantaleone was on there for, you know, about a year. He won an Emmy.
Oh, yeah.
You know, there's
Steve
a lot
Buscemi,
of. Yeah, there were a lot, you know, and I met all them once at a SAG Awards show.
Uh-huh.
And they all came over to me and they were like, oh, my God, and it's so nice to meet you. And I was like, oh, hi, yes, you know, like. They said, yeah, from Crime Story. We all know you from Crime Story. Oh, yeah, we loved you. So that was really sweet. That was really sweet.
Let's take a break. We're going to come back and talk about how you made the transition back to being on two hit series in a row. We'll be back with my pal, my new friend, hopefully, Tony Dennison, here on Absolutely Jason Stewart.
I'm Laura Somoza.
I'm Sterling Gardner.
And we are Between the Sheets every Monday here, 3 p.m., tradiov.com.
T-Radio-V.
That's right. It's T-Radio-V, radio in TV. What is that face?
She wants to see our hands.
That's radio in TV.
Wah, 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 wah.
We're not a couple.
Smoking big fatties. Hi, I'm Britta.
And I'm Taylor.
And together, we're the Cannabitches. Watch our show every Wednesday
at 12 p.m. or high noon.
It's a full hour of comedy, cannabis, and interviews.
And us being really stoned.
Hey, like, Britta.
Yeah. What's long and firm and filled with goodness?
Ooh, I'm thinking dirty thoughts, but
I'm thinking a big fat J.
Ooh! That's right. Every Wednesday, watch the Cannabitches get super stoned at 12 p.m.
Right here at T Radio V.
It's Radio in TV.
Dark matter. It's not like Amanda Joe, or it's just Joe?
Oh, it's just Joe with a dash after it.
Really? That's very, very strange. Oh. Joe Dash?
Are you the facts of life, Joe?
Are you the spawn of Down syndrome parents? J-O dash?
I think that we should all, for the rest of the show, add a dash to the ends of our names.
So, right.
So she doesn't feel bad. Dan Dash,
yes.
Jess Dash, Todd Dash, Dave Dash.
It's Dark Matter with Dave Navarro, Wednesdays at 9 p.m. on T Radio V.
Hey guys, I'm Danny Boy, and I'm Knocko Nolan. See what I mean? Hey guys, I'm Danny Boy O'Connor, and I'm Knocko Nolan. And we're the
That's not written down.
All right, well, I'm going to do it my way.
Okay.
No, it's okay. Watch us as we uncover. And we're the Delta Bravo Urban Exploration Team. Join us every Friday from 7 to 9 p.m. Pacific Standard Time.
Or 10 to midnight for our East Coast friends.
Watch us as we uncover, discover, and explore music, movie, and true crime locations. The Delta Bravo Show every Friday, 7 p.m. right here on T Radio V. Radio and TV. Just put your hand like that.
T Radio V. Radio in TV.
Radio in TV.
Hey, we're back. Absolutely Jason Stewart here, and we're talking to Tony Dennison, and we're talking about perseverance and tenacity and going for it. And I got to tell you, that's what I was like. I mean, I thought that God had waved a wand around my head and that I was meant to be. So I started at 8.
Yeah, that's a judgmental God, so forget about God is not judgmental the way we are. But anyway, like I was saying before, my career just took a left turn, a detour, and I didn't know what was going on. And I was literally going broke. It was 6.5 years where I did not, little teeny guest stars and little, really low-budget independent movies over the course of 6.5 years. My marriage was falling apart. I was going bankrupt. And it was interesting because I'm sober now, 21 years. So this is about 12 years ago when I was about 8 years sober. And I'm thinking to myself, what's going on in my life? Why is this happening? What did I do? I even thought about going to a psychic healer to see if maybe I was Genghis Khan in another life and I'm getting karmic paper. I said, what the hell?
Yeah.
But anyway, I learned during that period of time through work in my recovery program that I'm involved in, 12-step program that I'm involved in, that it really is important. I can't pay lip service to it. I've got to walk the talk, which is I've got to learn to become happy with who I am and not what I am, and that everything I have in my life is an extension, is the result of my happiness. Everything I have is a result of the happiness with who I am.
It's also a real guy thing because we sort of go, hi, Jason Stewart, plastics. Yeah. You know, we're taught from a
I would always identify myself as, oh, Tony Dennison, oh, yeah, I'm an actor.
Yeah.
I stopped doing that. Yeah. You know, and people say, you know, what do you do? I said, well, I earn my living as an actor. You know, but I'm more, you know, it's like I'm,
I think
everything I have is the result of my happiness.
All the kids now are complete hyphenates.
But I had to lose everything. I lost my home, my marriage, everything, you know, but even when I was made that discovery. And then about 2 years after I started really walking the talk and trying to exemplify that belief and that behavior, little things started to happen again. I got another series. It lasted like about 6 months, got canceled. It was Playmakers. It was the one, okay. It was the football. It was like unbelievably high-rated show on ESPN. But then there was all kinds of controversy because they said it was too real. And
what was the show called?
playmakers.
Oh wow!
Yeah, it was a great show.
I don't understand sports. You know.
I mean, if that show had made it past the first year, it would have been on for 10 years.
It's also probably a different time now. Things.
Yeah, it was like 19. I don't know when it was. 2003, I think.
I think things have really changed, and people are now open to watching things on all networks. Certainly, The Closer coming on TNT, being the highest rated basic cable show ever in history.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
And coming on with such gangbusters. And I think, you know, starting with Kara Sedgwick, who had been a movie star, mm-hmm. came on with this character that no one had ever seen before.
Well, James Duff wrote,
I was just going to say, James Duff.
He wrote a brilliant character. I mean, yeah. He wrote a brilliant pilot. And he, you know, he piloted a great series. He was
but he
executive
also brought
producer.
People on who were known from different areas from everywhere.
Well, I mean, see, like, again, when I go back to the thing saying about you never know, I've known James about 18 years now. So when this show came up, he said, you know, I really want you for the show. And whatever, the two characters that he thought I was right for, I just didn't get. The network said they weren't sure. They wanted an older guy. They wanted, you know, a younger guy, whatever.
Yeah.
So next thing you know, I'm not in the pilot. And, you know, this is a friend, and I'm like, oh, man. I said, all right. You know, my prayer was always to be happy. And I said, whatever comes, comes.
You weren't in the pilot?
No. No, I was, but I wasn't as a regular. So what happened was I get a call from James. There's a character in the pilot. His name is Lieutenant Flynn. He's got a great opening. You know, he opens the pilot. It's a 6.5-page scene. He said, and then there's a smaller scene later on. He said, would you like to do that? And I said, yeah, sure. I was like, you know, I thought to myself, man. I said, oh, but I went, yeah, okay, sure. I'd love to do it. And what happened as a result of that, the network said, we looked at this guy. We know who Tony Denison is. And when he showed up, we thought he was the lead of the show. And then Kira shows up, and they have a big fight, and he storms off. And so everybody in the room, we were watching the pile, wanted to know, where did he storm off to? And who is this guy? And so then they said, let's make him a reoccurring. So the first year I was a reoccurring character. They gave me more than, you know, the basic reoccurring salary. They didn't give me my quote, but they gave me a good
salary.
Yeah,
but it was also basic cable at that time, and everybody right. had a whole...
Oh, yeah, I was making good money.
There was a whole mishigas with that.
Yeah, I was for a reoccurring character, I was making really good money. And then what happened was Michael Wright, the head of TNT, said to James, you know, I wound up being in 9 of the 12 episodes. And he said, you know, there was 2 episodes in a row where I wasn't in. And he said, that's 2 episodes too many. Let's make Tony a regular. So then the second year, I was a regular. And I've been
that's
a regular
what happened
since.
With a couple people on the show.
So you never
correct?
Know.
Jonathan DeMarco.
DeLarco's now
DeLarco
a regular.
DeLarco now, he's
yeah.
a regular.
Yeah.
And so people sort of, they sort of, and it was always the more unusual people sort of got lifted back in. And then all of a sudden, and I heard this through Adam Belanoff, my person, is that they just sort of loved the chemistry between the two of you boys.
Oh, between G.W. Bailey and myself. Yeah,
yeah, they just, all of a sudden in the second season, it became like...
He's a wonderful actor. He's a wonderful man. He does work with kids with cancer, the Sunshine Kids. I mean, I don't
but
know where
he
has
the But
he
came from those
energy.
Crazy Police Academy movies. And that, so he, I mean, honestly, when you would do movies like that, you were known as a comedian. And yeah. you completely different
right.
kind of work.
He's a good actor.
Yeah, but I think basic cable has given people a chance to do things different, resurrect a career, change it, do something that you haven't played before.
Well, if you think about all the shows that are now on cable, they probably wouldn't have found the niche on network. And what made that possible is all the reality shows that the networks have been doing. People said, oh, taking away work from it. No, and what happened is it's given birth to cable. I mean, you know, you think about all the some of the best shows that are on television are on cable.
Oh, I think so.
You know, I mean, there's some good shows on the network, but the just so many shows that are on cable that have been on for years and years and years and stay on.
And also, what's really cool about the cable shows, I think, is that they're able to cast people and create shows with one showrunner, and maybe a second person who helps them, creating a single idea like they used to do. Like Mary Tyler Moore had James L. Brooks,
right.
and you know All in the Family had Norman Lear. The shows would come on, and Michael Mann, of course, Crime Story. You'd have one person take their idea, and it wasn't a show done by committee.
Right. Yeah. Like I said, Michael Mann, you know, gave me my break, created my career, helped my career to really flourish. And James now has been able to give me longevity. You know. in a way that I didn't think was ever going to happen again.
Because I know when they said, oh, we got Tony Denison to be in Dirty, and the producers, one of the producers called me, who's a friend of mine, Paul, and he was like, oh my God. And I said, how'd you get him? I said, you use my name? And
I
thought that was what's so neat about you is that you did this film. You're helping out these young filmmakers.
Yeah.
Paying it forward, mm-hmm. which is something I believe in big time. And for me, I would never get to play a guy who talks like this and he's, just a terrible asshole.
Well, a lot of the independents is kind of like the same, like independents are to feature films, what cable is to network television. It's an opportunity for people to go out and stretch themselves in ways that they might not get a chance to do in a big studio movie.
I did when I did The Closer 4 years ago. I got so many parts for that show.
You know what I have? I have the distinction of being, I don't know what other actors have this, but every single pilot I've done, and I've done seven of them, have all gone to series.
It's your lucky charm.
You know, obviously Closer and Major Crimes are the most successful in terms of longevity. You know, then Crime Story and then Playmakers. But all the other shows, I did a sitcom. I mean, so there's like seven. I did another show for James Duff earlier called The DA. It didn't make it. They got like a pickup for six. But every series, every pilot I've done has gone to series.
Wow.
So I'm the producer's, I'm their lucky penny.
So let's show a little clip. Why don't we show some stuff from The Closer and from a Major
Or Lucky Crime. Silver Dollar. I mean, given the inflationary rate of...
Or Susan B. Anthony Tubuck.
Yeah.
Why don't we show clip one, Major Crimes. Yeah, this is Flynn. Somebody made this up about you. I don't know who did it. Maybe it was a network or what, but they made this up about you and your relationship with Flynn.
Flynn, check this out.
You're Flynn.
You could fit a whole person in this thing.
Yeah, remind me not to come to your house for a barbecue.
Yeah, like I'd invite you.
Like you could cook.
It's like two little girls. Yeah. That's what's so funny.
It's great, right?
These two tough guys are like two kids.
You know.
How is this my fault?
Well, three words. Flynn and Provenza.
Have you ever seen this?
No, this is new to me. I've seen a lot of these compilation things, but I've not seen this
one. Provenza. That robot looks like you running.
Oh, you're so full of it, Flynn. You know that I don't run.
Oh, why don't you put that over here?
You sure?
Oh, trust me.
Don't worry about it. If you start to feel sick, just throw up all over Flynn.
Thank you,
sir. Blame it all on me.
Well, it's your damn garage. Look, I'm not going down for this.
You rat. Enough, does it?
George Andrews was the best partner a cop could ask for. Hands down.
Really? Thanks. Oh, my God.
I've made up my mind. I'm going to ask Lauren to marry me. I'm going to ask her.
Oh, I love that storyline.
I'm old, and I'm all alone.
Well, as usual, you're only half right. You're pretty old.
All right now. Don't jump to any conclusions. It was all his fault. Friend, here, read this one here. You do the highlighted parts, I'll do the doctor.
And I'm going to do the broad's role?
Yeah. He's dying, man. We've done all we can.
You've got to do something, Doc. Please, anything. Be my hero.
We should have shot them both.
So, you ready to go, Louie?
Call me that just once more, and Georgette will be my only ex-partner without a penis.
That was great.
Yeah.
I don't know who did that.
But I don't know. There's a lot of them. There's one now with Mary McDonald and me, you know, because there's this James.
What's going on?
Well, James is developing this relationship between us. I don't know if we'll actually become, you know, an item, or we'll just come close to it, or we'll just become even dearer friends. I mean, who knows? I mean, you know, James he's a pretty bright guy, so I leave it in his hands.
What I love is more than anything on the show between the two of you is the way you look at him, the silent kind of things, you know, because he seems to talk too much and you seem to just, it's enough.
Well, we have this, I think, if I could be presumptuous to say that G.W. Bailey and I take turns, in a sense, being Abbott and Costello.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, sometimes he's the straight man and I'm the, you know, the guy slipping on a banana peel, or vice versa, which I think is rare in television and in the movies, where both guys can, usually it's one guy who's always the, you know, let me tell you what we're going to do now.
It's a frickin' frat kind of thing.
Yeah, and that all happened one day with G.W. He started this. We were doing a scene.
We'll save that thought because they're playing the music. We're going to take a break and we're going to be right back with Tony Dennison here on Absolute Jason Stewart. And we're going to hear more about your relationship with this other man.
Okay.
Let's talk about the creation of what everybody loves you for, this demonic character, this loping, sad, beautiful monster. Where on earth did that come from?
Hi, everybody. I'm Gene Simmons. You're watching T Radio V.
I'm Michael DeBar, and Gene Simmons is on my show, The Michael DeBar Show, on Thursdays on T Radio V from 3 to 4. We'll see you then, won't we, Gene?
Be there or be square.
Radio V.
Go, go, go!
It's a desert in my mouth. Oh, God.
Whenever you go to Thai food and you get a dish with meat and rice, ask them to put an over-easy egg on top of it.
Oh, yes. My God.
And like, how eggs
Ooh,
are
I'm
so...
I'm getting excited about this egg right now.
T-Radio V is where you come to work and you drink, and you drink, and you get drunk.
Fork and Amazing, Mondays, 5 p.m. on T-Radio V, L.A.
Go, go, go.
Hi, I'm Ty Simpkins.
Miss Danielle Basuti.
Hi, this is Brooke Peoples.
I'm Jocelyn Donahue.
Hi, I'm Keegan Allen, and you're watching
T-Radio V.
T-Radio V.
T-Radio V, radio in TV.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Yes.
T-Radio V. Yo.
T-Radio V. Radio in TV.
Radio in TV.
Radio V. Radio in TV.
Radio in TV.
Hey, we're back at Absolutely Jason Stewart with my guest, Tony Dennison. And we were talking about your relationship with, I guess, Flynn.
G.W. Bailey.
Flynn and Parenza. I'm trying to remember. You're Flynn, he's Parenza. Because I think of you as your real names for some reason. So had you guys discussed this? Was there a lot of talking about how you were going to do it, or did it just evolve naturally?
Well, it just evolved. I mean, G.W. and I worked together on a series that I had done years ago called The Company, or was wound up being called Undercover. And G.W. was sort of reoccurring on the show. He played the head of the CIA. And that's the first time we met, which was about 22 years ago. And we had a great working relationship, and we got along, and he was a lot of fun. And then I didn't see him for like 15 years. And then the first day I saw him on the set, it was as if we hadn't seen each other in like 2 weeks. Just hit the ground running, so to speak. And we had, developed this great relationship. And one day we were doing, rehearsing, and I came over and I sat down on his desk while I was talking to him. And he goes to me, "Get your ass off my desk." And I looked at him and I said, "Excuse me?" And he says, "You heard me, get your ass off my desk." I said, "You care if I sit on your desk?" He goes, "Oh, I don't care." He goes, "But Provenza cares." So I said, "Oh, okay." So then I went with it. So he says, "Get your ass off my desk," in the rehearsal. And then I give him a look, like the look you were talking about before. And I stand up and James Duff said, "More of that. Let's do more of that." And then James wrote this episode. One day we were on location and he said, "You know, I'm thinking about doing an episode where Flynn and Provenza find a dead body in a garage." And we were like, "Okay." And he goes, and they, I just see this thing developing. So the episode came the following year.
Was that the one I was in, where they found the dead? Oh, that was in a storage facility.
Yeah, no, this was in his
another
garage.
Dead body.
There's another
that
in his garage, and it became the favorite episode of the fans for the whole 7.5 years of Major Crime of the Closer. It is, to this day, people still refer to that episode. You know, the skybox ticket episode or the dead body in the garage episode. And that was, James had just that little, like, sort of improv we were doing one day in a rehearsal. James went and took it to the point.
Did they let you improv on the show, the two of you?
Well, it's not like they let you improv. But if you have some ideas for stuff, you know, it's not like they don't let you improv. It's just that if you have an idea for something and you go over and talk to them about it, if they may polish it up or change it a little bit or just say, no, I believe that, you know, improvs and ad libs, if you're going to do that, I try to do them usually at the beginning or the end of the scene, because the body of the scene is really about the plot. So ultimately, I don't want to interfere with the plot, with anything I say.
Right, because there's a lot going on.
Right.
With, yeah.
So if I put it at the beginning or the end of the scene, they could just cut it out if they don't like it. And if they like it, they can leave it in. Or if they like it while we're rehearsing, they could say, then they could say, oh, edit over here. But as long as it comes from the writers, because, you know, I'm not a writer, and I do write, but I'm not writing the series. And I don't want to presume to say that I know better than these people.
The table read was a lot of fun.
The table read is very instrumental.
Do it?
Yeah, we do. Still do it now.
Oh, because I love that. That's where I met you the first time.
Right, yeah. James is...
And so supportive. I mean,
it's like theater. You know, you get a chance as an actor to sit and... And they get to hear it for the first time, and then they can make whatever adjustments. And they do. They always make a lot of adjustments after.
They changed the scene after I did it to use my... my way of speaking, mm-hmm. which rarely ever happens.
Right.
You know, rarely ever happens.
That's because James and that writing staff, they're that smart. They're that talented.
You know that, and I thought, wow, that just doesn't happen to me. I mean, especially as a guest actor on anything I've ever guested.
I mean, the show today is, it's like I said, it's this continuation of The Closer. It's now, it's new name, Major Crimes.
But 10 and, years, that's
and we
really...
Yeah, and we have Mary McDonald, who is...
Oscar nominee for
twice
for Passion
Oscar
Fish,
nominee.
Which is one of my favorite
and,
all-time
Dances
movies.
With Wolves.
Dances with Wolves, but Passion Fish is
Fish is good.
Is one of my all-time.
Yeah, I
favorite
did a John Sayles movie too.
Did you do which one?
I did City of Hope. Years and years ago. But
I thought so. That's one of the directors.
He's an interesting. He's one of those mavericks, true maverick. But Mary is just. I don't know. I can't say enough nice things about her. I really can't. I mean. And I don't mean that, you know, just to be like, you know, polite. She
no,
really
but
is
she
a
is,
sweetheart.
She's an extraordinary actress.
I say sometimes to people, if Mary is a fake, there's no hope for mankind. Because it can't be the way she is and
but
not be genuine.
Tell me, you have anything about John Sayles? That's one of my favorite.
John Sayles.
Baby, It's You.
Yeah, well, the movie I did, City of Hope, he cast me in it because...
Vincent Spano, right?
Yeah, Vincent Spano was the lead.
Who is my dream man, just to let you
know. Hell of a nice guy.
And the sweet... I've met him a couple times.
Well, I'd done a movie for Perry Lang. It was called Little Vegas with Catherine O'Hara and myself. And she was great to work
with. Funniest woman you've ever met in your entire life.
She is a national treasure, let me tell you. Anyway, so I was doing this movie, and John Sayles, because Perry had done Eight Men Out, had asked John to come on the show and come in the movie, and he played my neighbor in the trailer park, and we had like two scenes together.
Because he also acts and he also writes other screenplays for a lot of other movies.
So John called me up, or my agent called me, said, John Sayles wants you in his movie. And so when I went and worked on the movie, he was doing an interview one day, and he said, oh, that Tony was the first time he had ever cast somebody from a working experience that he had worked with as an actor.
Oh, wow.
And, you know, and he wanted to work with me, and he was great. He was great.
Well, my only regret is I didn't get to be in any of the scenes with you. Now, hopefully, Adam, my friend
Bellinoff,
who produces Major Crimes, keeps saying they want to bring Greg back somehow. For 4 years, he's been saying that to me.
As long as you're not dead, there's always hope.
Yeah. They didn't kill me. I just was a red herring, and I just got to, you know, find a dead body, and that's always a good thing. So we do a little Q&A thing at the end. I want to do a little quiz, but I want to ask you about, prison
Prison Break.
Prison Break with Wentworth Miller. Yeah, Wentworth Miller.
Yeah, and
you were great on that.
Dominic, what?
Yeah, you were great on that.
Yeah.
I mean, that was, you had to play the dad, right?
Yeah, that came out of left field. And again, James and TNT were very generous in allowing me to do that at the same time I was doing
the
closer.
Fox show.
It was a Fox show, and it was, but it just didn't work out ultimately because they wanted me for, you know, the season premiere kind of shows, for sweeps in September and November and sweeps in May. And that window of opportunity wasn't available because I was working the closer. It was during the period of time when we were on hiatus. So when I was on hiatus, I could do episodes that were shot in like October, November, December, January, February, and that was it. Then March all the way through to September, I had to be available.
And people have no idea how intense it is working on a series and how exhausting it is. You know, and the energy.
My father driving a tractor trailer around the streets of Manhattan—that was intense.
Yeah, but still, the energy, you know, of all of that is there's so much.
I mean, there's a lot of you know, emotional.
Yeah,
you got to be on your
this
game.
This has been an absolute pleasure. It really has. Where can people find you? Do you have a website or a Twitter? Or?
Yeah, at Real Tony Dennison is the Twitter.
One N.
Yeah, one N in the middle. At Real Tony Dennison.
And
I have a Facebook page that my publicist put together. And now my dear friend and business partner, Joel Bess, has been saying, you got to do Instagram, so I got Instagram.
We're all
going
trying. If you need to get a hold of him, just go to jasonstewart.com, STUART. Thank you so much for being on the show.
That's it? Time's up?
Yeah.
It's
been
great.
An hour.
Boy, that was like
3 seconds, huh?
Yeah.
Take care, everybody.
You are watching T Radio V. Radio and TV.